Centaur Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Attack on Thebes by M.D. Cooper. Narrated by Cris Dukehart. Previously in the Orion War. Attack on Thebes begins to gather some threads together from prior books, and we encounter some characters that we've not seen for a while. While the Scipio Alliance focused very closely on Tanis and her daughters, Attack on Thebes broadens the scope once more to give us a view of what's happening on the larger stage. At the tail end of Orion Rising, we saw what happened to Adrian, one of the former president's closest advisors, when he returned to Airtha. His son was killed and he was captured by Sera, but not the Sera who was allied with Tanis. Airtha, the AI that was once Sera's mother, has crafted a second daughter. Not a clone, exactly, but another version of her. This second Sera has many of the same attributes, thoughts, and even memories, but she is fiercely loyal to her mother. When Sera captured Adrian, his son died in the attack, but his daughter, Kara, got away. Kara ended up being rescued by what is quite possibly the most unlikely person, Katrina. If you've not read the Warlord books, then the last time you saw Katrina was 5,000 years ago on the Victoria colony at Captain Star. However, Katrina had some of her own adventures and has also made her way to the 90th century. In this book, you'll see more of how that came to pass and what Katrina and Kara's part to play in this is. Though the events in Collision Course drew Tanis and the I-2 out of Scipio, this book will start back with Empress Diana and Petra, before moving forward to the Silstrand system to deal with the nanotech-related mess there. Still lying ahead is the retribution Tanis craves for the Tressiliads after they attacked Carthage and killed so many. However, Tanis is now on the hunt for the Caretaker, the mysterious ascended being that left a piece of itself inside Nance, and was also controlling events in Silstrand and beyond. Key characters rejoining us. Abby, wife of Ernest and former chief engineer aboard the Intrepid. Andrea, Sarah's sister who used a back door into Sarah's mind to make Sarah try to kill Tanis in the Acela system. Adrian, Transcend Secretary of State and close confidant of the former president, Jeffrey Tomlinson. Carrie, Tanis's biological daughter, has a trait where she can deep link with other people, creating a temporary merger of minds. Corsia, ship's AI and captain of the Andromeda. Diana, empress of the Scipian Empire. Felina, Tanis's AI daughter, born of a mind merge between Tanis, Angela, and Joe. Justin, former director of the Hand, was imprisoned for the events surrounding the attempted assassination of Tanis. Katrina, former Syrian spy, wife of Marcus, and eventual governor of the Victoria colony at Captain Star, and warlord of the Midaterra system. Kara, daughter of Adrian, heavily modded with four arms and wings. Nadine, a Hand agent who had been assigned to assassinate Peter Rhoads, and is now aboard the I-2. Nance, former member of Sabrina's crew, now a member of the ISF. Petra, regional director of the Hand's operations in Scipio and nearby territories, now the Transcend's ambassador to Scipio. Priscilla, one of Bob's two avatars. Rachel, captain of the I-2, formerly captain of the Enterprise. Sanvi, Tanis's adopted daughter, found in a derelict ship that entered the new Canaan system. Sera of Airtha, a copy of Sera made by Airtha, containing all of Sera's desired traits and memories, president of the Airthan faction of the Transcend. Smithers, S&H employee Tanis licensed her nanotech to on the Petzl mining platform during her first visit to Silstrand. Terry, director of the Security Operations Center on the I-2, a member of Tanis's original SOC team. Troy, ship's AI aboard the Excelsior, was on the mission to secure fuel for the Intrepid in Estrella de la Muerte and sacrificed himself to save the Intrepid in the battle for Victoria. Daughter of Airtha. Stellar date, August 14, 8948. Adjusted years. Location, Airtha Capital Complex. Region, Airtha Hugin System. Transcend Interstellar Alliance. Sera watched Adrian enter her office, the space so recently occupied by her father, from where the formerly great President Geoffrey Tomlinson had ineptly run his expansive empire. Adrian had to know he was defeated, know that Sera controlled him utterly, but still he strode in as though he was the master of all he saw. She turned away from him, looking out the window at the sweeping arch of Airtha, wrapped around the gleaming white dwarf star. Once, this star-encircling ring had been her mother's body, a prison her father had forced on Justina after she returned from the galaxy's core. He even stripped her of a name, simply calling her Airtha, as though she were just an NSAI whose purpose was nothing more than the management of the structure in which it was installed. But his efforts to both control his former wife and keep her close had been thwarted. Mother had ascended. Airtha was no longer an AI, a neural network of physical components constructed out of non-organics. Now she was something more, a being of light that existed in more than the few paltry dimensions that made up the corner of space-time that creatures like Adrian crawled through. Granted, Sera also existed in the same narrow sliver of existence, but her mother had given her a glimpse of what lay beyond, the power that existed at her fingertips. Her mother had gifted her with that vision and with a piece of herself. Not a shard, but a sliver of self that an AI like Bob might carve off, such as what Helen had been. What Sera now possessed was a full representation of her mother, like a thinking memory. She would never be separated from her mother again.
"Surveying your domain?" Adrian asked as he reached her side. "What little of the transcend you've managed to claim?"
"She's claimed no more than I," Sera shot back, annoyed that Adrian would open with a critical remark such as that. Adrian shrugged.
"Perhaps. She has Vila, snatched it out from under you. Admiral Crissy is a formidable opponent on her own."
Sera nodded. "Mother regrets not directing more resources toward Crissy's destruction after the debacle at the Grey Wolf Star. But it was not expected that Phineas would return and connect Crissy to New Canaan."
"I thought the great Airtha was all-knowing,"
Adrian sneered. "Do I need to kill more of your children to remind you who's in command here?" Sera asked. "You seem to forget your place with startling regularity." Adrian drew himself up to his full height.
"My place is beside President Tomlinson. I should never have left it."
"You are beside President Tomlinson," Sera replied, giving the man a sidelong look of annoyance.
"I'm beside a shadow of Sera Tomlinson, a puppet created by Airtha. How does it feel to be a puppet, false Sera? Do you have strings?"
He waved a hand over her head, a mocking smile on his face. Sera growled and spun, her hand slamming into Adrian's throat, her other hand planting on his forehead, a tendril of nano flowing out and connecting to his nerves, lighting them afire. "Is this false?" she hissed. "Don't think that you can trick me into killing you. I can cause you unending pain without ever doing that." Adrian was gasping for air, and she kicked his legs out from under him and then let go, dropping the man to the floor. "You're pathetic, Adrian.
And you're unhinged. Unstable,"
he rasped.
"One of these times you'll do it, you'll kill me. And I'll be free of this prison you've put my mind in."
Sera shrugged. "Perhaps I will. After I'm convinced that you've revealed all your children to me." The building's NSAI alerted Sera that her guest had arrived, and she turned from the gasping man to greet the newcomer as he approached. "Ah, General Garza. So glad you arrived safely." The Remnant. Stellar date, August 15, 8948. adjusted years. Location, Gamma 8 Base. Region, Outer Asteroid Belt, New Canaan System. Carrie watched Ernest's eyes grow wide as she walked into his lab in the Gamma 8 Base. She still cradled the remnant within her hands, the glowing ball that held the thing that had been inside Nance for so long. She was accompanied by her father, Sanvi, and two medtechs who stood behind the stasis pod that held Nance. Sanvi had wanted to wake Nance, or to at least try, but their father had insisted that she be put into stasis. His argument was that they didn't know what the thing had done to her. She could be fine, or she could have a trigger nestled within her mind. There could even be more of the remnant still in her, though Carrie didn't think that was the case. She couldn't feel any more of it, at least.
So, that's it. A piece of an ascended being,
Ernest whispered and gestured toward a table half covered in equipment standing in the center of the room.
Bring it over here. I want to scan it to see if you need to keep holding it.
I think she's managed to encapsulate it with magnetically charged membranes,
Sanvi offered. Ernest nodded while not removing his eyes from the sphere in Carrie's hands.
Perhaps, but if it is a brain, it's a black brain. An M5, at least.
He glanced up at Sanvi.
It'd have to be, since this is not a three-dimensional being, though the brain certainly isn't black, is it?
All I know is that it hurts my eyes to look at it, Carrie said as she leaned on the table. Though it's funny, it didn't when Sanvi, Feline, and I were conjoined.
Yeah, it was clear then. I could see it as a thing. Now it's just noise,
Feline added.
I feel left out,
Sanvi said with a mock pout.
It always just looked like, well, not noise, just a thousand Mobius strips or something.
Ernest slid a porous metal plate under Carrie's outstretched hands and then swung another device over top.
Spread your hands out a bit more, Carrie, so that there's a gap below them.
Carrie complied, looking nervously at the device above her hands.
What is that? It looks a bit like
a gamma ray gun,
Ernest completed for her.
Don't worry, it's low power and very focused. The metal foam below your hands will absorb any residual radiation from the gammas, as well as imaging a 3D representation of the object. It might tell us a bit more about what we're dealing with here.
What if the brain splits open? Or whatever they do, when they fail?
Sanvi had stepped up beside Carrie as she spoke and was peering into the orb. Ernest paused.
That could be a problem. Unlikely, but certainly not desirable.
I'll second that,
Joe added.
How do we know it's safe to do this at all? Perhaps you should work on containing it first.
It is contained, Dad,
Sanvi said.
Now, we need to sort out how to detect them and contain them without Carrie.
Let's not jump to conclusions, Sanvi.
Ernest stroked his chin as he stared at the orb.
For all we know, this is a defensive measure it took to avoid whatever you were going to do to it.
What we were going to do to it? Carrie asked. Ernest nodded, his eyes still fixed on the orb.
Yes. What were you going to do to it?
I wanted to crush it.
Felina's tone was sour and a bit spiteful. Sanvi pressed a hand to her forehead and nodded slowly.
I recall a similar sentiment. That's what I was going to do, Carrie said. But then I stopped because I knew that we needed it alive or whatever. There are probably more of these infesting New Canaan.
Ernest looked up at Carrie and Sanvi.
So I'm to assume that you're no longer deep-linked?
Yeah, it didn't seem to be required anymore. The thing stopped fighting, and it's difficult to remain linked like that for long.
Well, I'm detecting increased activity in there. You'd better do your thing again, girls. I suspect it's not excited about meeting Mr. Gamma Ray here, and it may try to break out.
Okay, let's hook up then.
Carrie reached out to Feline and Sanvi, visualizing their minds as spheres of light that she dipped her hands into and then drew toward herself.
Ernest's eyes narrowed.
Are you linked?
We are. Carrie Sanvi Felina watched the writhing mass within the sphere coalesce into a recognizable shape once more. She didn't know what the shape was. No words came to mind to describe it. But she could see its edges, make out filaments.
You ready?
Ernest asked. Carrie glanced back at her father, who nodded.
Might as well get it over with.
He sighed. Do it, Carrie Sanvi Felina said. Ernest activated the gamma ray, which resulted in a very anticlimactic and almost imperceptible... The remnant, however, roiled inside the ball, pushing out in all directions, forcing Carrie Sanvi Felina to place more of the black bands around it. When they had first captured the remnant, they'd not understood what they did to contain it. This time was different. Carrie Sanvi Felina could see other things all around herself now, extra planes and angles, as though another existence was encroaching on their own. There were light things and dark things, hot and cold things. The hot things were black, and Carrie Sanvi Felina could take them and wrap them around the remnant. In the other space, the remnant was larger, as tall as her father, but still somehow on the table and cupped in her hands. It seemed to rage, to exude a sense of purpose denied. Stop, Carrie Sanvi Felina said to the remnant. Stop, or we will crush you this time.
Do you really think you can?
The remnant seemed to hiss and steam as it spoke. Carrie Sanvi Felina nodded. We do. We see through you. You're just a shadow, not a real being.
Real enough, the remnant replied. You won't be able to hold me forever. I must find the others and expunge them. They no longer serve a purpose.
The more Carrie Sanvi Felina watched the remnant, the more she realized that it was little more than a memory, perhaps an ascended AI's version of a non-sentient AI assistant. But it was smart and had wiles. It had to for it to have hidden in Nance for so long, and to have escaped the notice of Bob. How could this thing have escaped Bob's notice? Carrie Sanvi Felina wondered to themselves. He is all but ascended himself. If he cannot perceive extra-dimensional entities such as this remnant, we would be surprised.
Carrie.
Her father's voice broke into her thoughts.
What's going on? It looks like the thing is going to explode.
We're talking to it. Carrie Sanvi Felina replied, her voice calm and reassuring. At least she hoped it was. It is blustering, currently. I think it's an NSAI of sorts. It doesn't have many tricks up its sleeve, so it's attempting to use fear. But I think that it fears us, so much as it can.
Well, whatever you're doing is working better than the gamma ray. I'm getting excellent data.
Ernest had summoned a dozen holodisplays and was frantically working on them as he spoke.
Is it actionable data?
Joe asked. Ernest shot Carrie Sanvi Felina's father a sharp look.
Joe, I'm learning about an entirely new branch of physics over the course of just a few minutes. I mean, we have theories, but we've never tangibly interacted with these other dimensions, not in real time, like this at least.
Ernest's voice grew breathless as he spoke. A combination of excitement and worry was clearly audible. Carrie Sanvi Felina realized that she could see Ernest's physical presence in the additional dimensions as well, but not as a tangible thing. More like a shadow. She turned to see that her father and the medtechs, who looked more than a little concerned, had the same shadows. Nance's stasis pod was a pocket of nothingness in the other dimensions, which was interesting in and of itself.
Stars, your names are exhausting to string together.
Ernest peered at Carrie, then Sanvi.
Mind if I just call you CSF?
Not FSC? Carrie said, her voice sounding like her younger sister's.
Whichever you prefer.
Ernest shrugged. Call us the Triad. Ernest laughed and Joe sighed.
A bit pretentious, don't you think, girls?
Well, Dad, we are three. Okay, How's about trine?
Sure. Ernest nodded. Now that we have that out of the way, I want to stimulate it again with the gamma ray, but at a different energy level.
I want to try something first. Trine, Carrie splayed her fingers, and filaments of nano flowed out of them and onto the surface of the brain. It has a body, Trine Sanvi said. I can see it through Trine Carrie's eyes. Though to mine, it is still a jumble. But the body we see here and the remnant's real body are not the same. It is complete in other parts of space-time, while it's a shadow here. No, that is not right. It is a shadow in others too, like it has shed much of itself, to be what it is. It is a facsimile, Trine Felina said.
I am no such thing, the remnant retorted. You cannot understand what you see.
Trine Carrie had deposited enough nano on the surface of the brain that it was visible as silver bands wrapping around the black ones. Then the bands began to glow brightly, and the silver sank into the black.
How is she doing this?
Trine heard her father ask Ernest.
I don't know,
Ernest replied.
If you don't know, how is it that she knows?
Trine watched Ernest peer into Trine Carrie's eyes.
When you were a baby, and you took your first step, did you know how your muscles worked? How your brain sent a signal through your nervous system?
Are you saying this is some sort of innate knowledge? A reflex or something?
Well, not a reflex, but yes, something that Trine knows how to do naturally.
Where would Carrie...
Not Carrie.
Ernest held up a finger.
When Trine merges, each brings themselves, or at least a part, into the whole. To be honest, what Carrie instigates is something I barely understand to begin with. It's like she's able to affect the merger that her mother and Angela have, but at will, and with anyone.
Not anyone, Trine Carrie said. I've tried it with others, but only succeed with Sanvi and then Felina.
Even so, Sanvi's not a blood sister, so whatever bond allows this is not biological. I suspect your inability to deep link with others is a mental block, nothing more.
Trine only grunted as she spun the silver bands around the remnant. In three-dimensional space, it seemed only to roil more violently inside the sphere. In N-space, a name she decided on for the deeper existence she could now see, it shrieked in pain, or possibly terror. Trine wasn't certain.
So you think this ability to see into other dimensions and manipulate matter there comes from Felina?
Joe said after a moment. Trine wondered about that. It made sense. On previous deep links with Sanvi, there had never been any revelations about other dimensions. Nothing had ever looked different. Could it be because moms are merging? Trine Carrie thought. Perhaps, Trine Felina replied, her thoughts feeling uneasy. Does that mean that moms are becoming something more as well? Are we? Or at least you two? Trine Sanvi sounded as though she didn't know what to think of her place in Trine. Trine Carrie did not think that was the case. Seeing more of space-time does not mean that we're becoming anything different, other than having other eyes at least.
You didn't say anything about moms.
Trine Felina couldn't help but comment.
That's because I don't know what's happening with moms. Focus. Yes, of course.
While Trine had been talking amongst herself, she had also been listening to Joe and Ernest discuss what they were seeing.
See there?
Ernest pointed at one of his hollows.
When she twists that band, the thing emits shadow particles, mostly sleptons. I believe I can detect those under a variety of circumstances. They have a very unique signature. We'll just have to figure out how to force it to emit those.
There,
Trine said as the last of the black bands was fully coated in silver. You now have a control interface for it. In N-space, the remnant had ceased its struggles. It was now wrapped in the silver ribbons that Trine had created. Unlike the representation in three-dimensional space, where the bands wrapped around it and things looked neat,
end space showed the ribbons very differently. There, they mostly encircled the remnant, but in some places, they punctured it as well, passing through its body in some dimensions, but not others. The result was a being that was afraid to move, lest it cut itself apart. And because for the remnant, thought was movement, it could barely form words.
We'll be free.
Keep dreaming. Trine replied, her tone dismissive. Internally, though, she was not so sure. Can it? We don't know. If it is NSAI, it is just acting out its programming. And if this shadow is sentient, then it has a will. We must stay to watch it.
So tired.
Carrie severed the deep link, feeling Sanvi fall away first, then Felina, though Felina did not drift far.
That's exhausting,
Carrie said, leaning heavily on the table.
You've not slept for 3 days,
her father said, at her side in an instant with a gentle hand on her arm.
You need to eat, then sleep.
Can't, Carrie whispered. What if it breaks free?
I have a cot in the corner,
Ernest said.
I can have food brought down.
Sleep.
Sanvi nodded in agreement.
I caught shut-eye on the trip here, so I can stay up a while. I'll let you know if we need you.
As will I,
Felina added.
Okay, just for an hour or so.
Carrie nodded as her father led her to the cot.
Just a bit.
Carrie didn't even remember her head hitting the pillow. Farewell to Scipio. Stellar date, October 2, 8948. Adjusted years. Location, Imperial Palace. Region, Alexandria, Bosporus System, Scipio Empire. 2 months later. You know, Diana, you're not half bad. Tanis nearly spat out her wine, wondering what had come over Sera to say something like that to the Empress. She gave Sera a stern look before seeing, to Tanis's immeasurable relief, that the Empress smiled.
The feeling's mutual, Seraphina. I recall watching you enter my audience room and thinking, now there's a woman who really thinks she's more than she is.
Petra sat down on a chair across from the Empress. I imagine Sera and Tanis are certainly more than you expected them to be. She took a small sip of her wine before leaning forward to place it on the low table between them. Diana's eyes twinkled, and her lips pursed for a moment before she responded.
I was thinking of you, Petra.
Petra's eyes narrowed and her neck and shoulders tensed, but the ambassador held her tongue.
Ouch. Diana's still making Petra pay for all our sins.
Angela commented privately to Tanis.
No one ever said she was a kind woman. Makes her just the sort of ally we need, I think.
Merciless toward her enemies. You know that can backfire, right?
Tanis considered Angela's words. If there was one axiom to live by, it was that if a person was cruel to their enemies, they could just as easily be cruel to you. Humans were excellent at rationalizing their behavior when it suited them.
She's our best option to stall the hegemony.
Tanis knew it was a weak argument, but she still had hopes for Diana. She'd changed over the past 2 months and grown as a person. Tanis liked to think that she and Sera were positive influences on the Empress, showing her how one could rule while being empathetic.
And if our sources are right, a rift may be forming between General Garza and hegemon Uriel.
Angela added,
with us backing Scipio, the hegemony won't be able to stand against them alone.
Tanis turned that idea over in her mind as she watched Diana, Petra, and Sera chat idly in Diana's meeting lounge. Would Diana annex the hegemony entirely? By the Empress's own words, she didn't want to expand the boundaries of her empire any further. But would she feel the same way once Sol was in her hands? Tanis hoped the woman would maintain her current stance. Scipio having control of its empire as well as the hegemony of worlds was too much. Too much for anyone.
I see where you're going with that train of thought.
Angela's voice was soft and encouraging.
You wonder what will happen after this war's over. Where the lines will be redrawn.
I do,
Tanis replied simply.
Are we going to make things worse in the long run? FTL created the opportunity for wars unlike any others. But even with dark layer travel, it still takes years to get across the inner stars. This war is going to seed jump gates all across known space.
Tanis felt Angela's agreement fill her mind. So long as we can keep a tight lid on how to make jump gates, they can be limited, even destroyed if needs be. This is a more manageable issue than dark layer FTL.
Or it will allow for someone in the future to create the ultimate tyranny.
Angela snorted, then began to chuckle.
What's so funny? Tanis asked, feeling annoyed at her friend.
You, Angela said after her laughter had died down. You're not content with the trouble you have before you. You're borrowing it from future millennia.
While we're at it, we should worry about what will happen to human civilization when the Andromeda Galaxy collides with the Milky Way.
Tanis had a sharp retort ready, but then realized how right Angela was.
Okay, point taken. I was getting a bit melodramatic there.
A bit? Angela was still chuckling softly. Though I'll grant you that we do have to think about who will fill the power vacuums that we'll create.
I really don't want to become the Galactic Policewoman.
Me either, I...
You with us, Tanis? Sera waved a hand in front of Tanis's face.
Tanis looked at Sera, then Petra and Diana, all of whom were directing unblinking stares her way.
Yeah, sorry, was just thinking about what's stacked up ahead of us.
A great list of deeds, I imagine. Diana said, the fact that I just have to contend with one enemy, provided you get Silstrand and that Rhoads mess under control, is a great relief to me.
Tanis nodded and reached for her wine glass.
I made the mess in Silstrand, I'll fix it.
And now you have the same nanotech that Tanis gave them, Diana, Sera added. So there's no need to worry that they have an advantage you don't.
True.
Diana nodded with a smirk on her gleaming black lips.
So long as they keep their stretch of stars from becoming a problem, I don't see a treaty being a problem.
And the fleet you'd send to take Gedry?
Sera pressed. Diana laughed and shook her head.
President Seraphina Tomlinson, do you not trust me?
Sera cocked an eyebrow.
Trust, but verify. I have too many variables to juggle right now to worry about loose ends like this. Like Tanis, I feel partly responsible for the mess in Silstrand. I'd prefer to know that it's taken care of.
We received confirmation today. Petra's tone carried mild annoyance as her eyes locked on Diana's.
Petra, you're always spoiling my fun.
Not everything needs to be a game of wits, Empress.
Petra and Diana stared at one another for a moment before Diana shrugged.
I suppose. I do need to learn not to needle my allies. I'm just not used to having people I can really trust.
Do you worry about Petra's allegiance?
Tanis asked Sera.
She seems more beholden to the Empress than you.
Are you referring to her use of we when referring to Scipio?
Sera asked.
I certainly marked it. Stars, marked it. I'm starting to talk like Diana. Kill me now.
Don't worry. Angela joined in their conversation. Alistair's keeping an eye on Petra. There's nothing wrong with her having a strong loyalty to Scipio. Eventually, these political divisions will have to lessen.
Whoa. Now who's prognosticating about the future?
Tanis asked.
We trust you, Diana.
Sera said aloud. By your own admission, you don't want to build a larger empire than what you have. Seeing proof of that is welcome.
Diana's expression grew guarded.
True. But if I do advance into the hegemony, which I intend to do soon, we won't just sit here and let them build up for a crushing attack against us. I will need to give some consideration to governance of conquered territory.
I'm in favor of vassal states with as much autonomy as possible, Petra said. Half the hegemony of worlds is annexed territory as it stands. Many would welcome their autonomy back.
Diana's eyebrows rose as she regarded Petra.
A desire for autonomy does not equate to the ability to effectively self-govern.
Easy, Di. I did say vassal states.
Diana shrugged. I suppose you did.
So, how are you and Tanis getting along? Tanis asked, seeking a new direction for the conversation.
Very well, Diana replied. I'd forgotten how nice it is to share one's mind with an AI. We're thick as thieves, as they say.
It's going to be a fun experience, Tanis added. A lot of responsibility.
You're not running the Empire, though, Diana replied with a laugh. Trust me, when the buck stops at your ass, everything is a lot different.
I know I'm not running it, but everyone sure thinks I know everything about everything that is going on everywhere. It's draining.
Diana's laughter faded and she nodded soberly. Welcome to my life. That's a woman of a thousand masks, Sera commented to Tanis and Angela. I wonder if she even knows who she is half the time.
I think she does, Angela said. There's a firm core of self within her. I think that core is a bit of a jerk, but it's there.
Sera nearly laughed aloud at Angela's statement, and Tanis smiled, watching Petra say something to Sera as Diana looked on. There was a strength in Diana, an unalterable belief that her actions were the best way forward for her people, despite short-term pitfalls. Tanis knew all too well how that felt. Myriad Concerns. Stellar date, October 2, 8948. Adjusted years. Location, ISSI-2. Security Operations Center. Region, Alexandria Bosporus System. Scipio Empire. Captain Rachel Espenson let out a long, frustration-laden sigh as she sat in one of the chairs in Terry's office. Tanis and Sera are due back on the ship in another day, she said. Their negotiations with Scipio are over. We're preparing to leave the Bosporus system.
You say this like I don't understand the implications, Terry replied. Trust me, this upsets me just as much as it does you.
Rachel pressed the heels of her hands into her eyes. You're right, Terry. You've been responsible for this ship's safety longer than I've been alive.
Captain Espenson.
Terry rose and took a seat next to Rachel. She reached out and placed a hand on her shoulder.
This ship has survived worse than this. We'll sort it out. We always do.
You're right. Rachel nodded and squared her shoulders as she gazed out over the I-2 Security Operations Center. Though it was far from the bridge, the SOC was one of the ship's many hearts, always bustling with activity. The work of keeping the massive vessel safe was never over, especially not with all of the Scipian dignitaries touring it. But knowing that we brought someone with us from New Canaan who would free Elena, who could fool our sensors.
You're worried it's a remnant.
Aren't you? Rachel asked. We can't detect them. Bob doesn't even think he can. Any one of us could have one of those things inside us.
I'll admit that it does unnerve me, but Ernest has the remnant that Tanis's daughters were able to remove from Nance. Once he fully understands it, he'll determine a way to detect them.
Rachel nodded. At least I know I don't have one inside me. From what I read in the reports, Nance knew it was there all along. She just couldn't say anything about it to anyone.
Yep.
Terry nodded seriously as she cast an appraising eye at Rachel.
Which means you could be lying to me right now.
Terry!
Captain!
Terry laughed.
You need to relax. I don't think there's a remnant in you. I think that whoever it's in is someone who can slip about with little notice.
Rachel joined in Terry's laughter.
Well, you're right about that. I can't walk more than 10 paces without someone rushing after me with questions or pinging me over the link or both, simultaneously from the same person.
When was the last time you had a day off, Captain? Terry's tone was innocent, but her eyes belied concern.
Stars.
Rachel looked at the rooms overhead, thinking back.
Sometime before President Tomlinson, the previous President Tomlinson, dropped in for a visit with his fleet.
Maybe you should see if you can take a day or two during our next stop. It would help if we knew where that was.
Terry shrugged.
Somewhere in the Silstrand Alliance, or the fringe systems between it and Scipio. That crusading fleet of AI haters is in there somewhere. From what I hear, stopping them is a part of the treaty with Scipio.
Rachel nodded and visualized the region of space surrounding Scipio. On the rimward side was a no-man's land of small independent systems. Beyond them was the Silstrand Alliance, a narrow strip of stability in a region known for general lawlessness. On the far side of the fringe systems were a series of larger alliances and federations, tucked up against the hegemony of worlds and stretching to the Praesepe Cluster. I remember Tanis' stories of Silstrand. Parts of it sound nice.
Terry snorted. And parts of it sound barely civilized.
Maybe that's just what I need. Rachel wondered what it would really be like to visit a place where lawlessness ruled. She'd seen them in vids, but her practical experience was much more limited.
Trust me.
Terry replied. You've not missed much with your sheltered upbringing. Shitty locales are mostly just shitty. Plus, there's the whole part where I have to send a security detail with you and worry that you're gonna get killed the whole time.
Rachel laughed and shook her head at Terry. You worry too much.
Of course I do. That's my job. Now go fly your starship from your big chair. We'll find whoever let Elaine out, I promise.
Rachel didn't have anything encouraging to say, so she simply nodded and walked out of Terry's office, eyeing everyone she passed, wondering if they could have a remnant of an ascended AI in them, making them do things, subverting the mission.
Aftermath. Stellar date, October 8, 8948. Adjusted years. Location, Bridge. ISF, I-2. Region, Outer Silstrand System. Silstrand Alliance.
So much for a spa day, Rachel said as she stared at the holotanks showing the wreckage of the fleets around Dessen.
Priscilla glanced back at Rachel, the woman's black eyes appearing as endless pools of night on her alabaster skin.
Not a lot of R&R in our future, Captain. I think we may see things like this play out for some time.
Us crushing enemy fleets like they're nothing? Rachel asked. It sounds crazy to say it, but I feel bad for them. It's like shooting fish in a barrel.
Priscilla nodded as she turned to gaze at the holotanks as well.
Yes, that is an apt analogy. If the barrel is made of wood, and we have a nuke.
I don't think the barrel's material matters if we have a nuke.
It could be a very, very big barrel, made of some sort of...
Priscilla's voice faded.
Never mind. That was getting stupid.
Rachel rose and walked to the holotank, watching the SNR crews as they scoured the ships for survivors. Four fleets were spread out near the dwarf planet Dessen in the Silstrand system, the smallest of which was the ISF fleet, a mere 40 ships, though all unscathed thanks to their stasis shields. Next were the ships of the Silstrand Alliance Space Force, of which there were only 45 still intact. Granted, over 100 were closing in from all around the Silstrand system. Next were the private military ships of SNH Defensive Armaments. While their ships were smaller in mass, there were over 100 of them. They had taken heavy damage, but it was also their installation on, or in, rather, the dwarf planet Dessen that had been the target. The last group was the Revolution Fleet. Hundreds of ships, most massing far more than even the Silstrand Alliance vessels. Yet it was the fleet that lay in ruin. The battle had been 3-1, and though the one outnumbered the rest, when the I-2 arrived, the outcome had become a foregone conclusion. In fact, their greatest struggle in the brief, fierce conflagration had been to keep the SNH defensive forces from utterly destroying the Revolution fleet. Those poor bastards. Rachel said quietly, mind-controlled and just plain deluded. They didn't deserve to die horribly just because some crazy man put mind control mods into all their heads. That someone could even do such a thing with impunity disgusted Rachel. How had the inner stars fallen to such barbarism? How was it possible that a man could amass such a fleet, filled with people who hated AI so much that they'd die for their cause, and no one had stopped him before he got this far?
Sure is a mess.
A voice said on Rachel's left, and she turned to see Tanis at her side.
Ma'am.
Rachel nodded deferentially. How did your chat go with that madman's daughter?
She didn't support anything he was doing, if that's what you're wondering.
Tanis replied. She's the one who killed him and severed his control over his people. Rachel backtracked through the battle in her mind. She got his flagship 3 hours before the last enemies were taken out. Did it take some time for people to regain themselves?
Not from what she told us. It seems that there were a lot of true believers who had no need for coercion to hate AIs. I suspect that many of the folks we're picking up out there required no unnatural influences to take up arms.
Rachel shook her head. What a shame. What are your orders, Admiral? Are we going to be here for a while?
Well, given that this system is the seat of the Silstrand Alliance's government, I expect we'll be here for a bit, yes. The Scipian Special Envoy will need to meet with the Silstrand President and ratify a treaty. Diana requires the Transcend as a signatory. Rachel couldn't hold back a sardonic laugh. Sounds like the very definition of fun. Isn't that the truth?
Rachel glanced at the Admiral to see a distant look in the woman's eyes.
Still, Tanis continued, no matter who wanted us to do what, we did stop a genocidal purge here. I would have done it just for that. Helping sidestep a war between Scipio and Silstrand is just icing on the cake.
Sounds like two marks in the win column, Rachel said, pantomiming making the marks.
It does, doesn't it?
Tanis nodded.
You know, I have interesting memories of this system.
This is where you got Sabrina the weapon upgrades, so you could rescue Sera, right?
Tanis gave a soft laugh. Yeah, amongst other things. Cheeky and I got up to some crazy stuff on one of their stations.
You what? Rachel asked loudly, her eyes wide before lowering her voice. What did you do with Cheeky?
Captain, Tanis admonished. I did nothing untoward with Cheeky. She and I got in a bit of trouble, is all.
Now that's a story I'd like to hear sometime.
Maybe over drinks some night.
Tanis replied.
For now, I'd best go meet with the Silstrand fleet liaison, a Colonel Grayson. He and I have to pay a visit to Smithers and his hidey hole on Dessen, or in Dessen. Whatever.
Rachel remembered Colonel Grayson. She'd watched him disembark when his ship docked.
I see that look in your eyes.
Tanis wagged a finger in the air.
I'd recommend against pursuing that man. I'm pretty certain he has eyes only for Kylie Rhoads.
Rachel mused. I suppose it's not worth it anyway. He won't be here long.
Stars willing.
Tanis nodded and turned to leave.
Keep me appraised on the cleanup. At some point, Silstrand is going to demand that we turn over all the prisoners, and I want to have a good handle on the situation when that occurs.
Of course, Admiral, Rachel replied as Tanis strode off the bridge. The Admiral gone, Rachel turned back to the holotank, wondering about all those people who had been swept up by Peter Rhoads' false promises and conscripted in his fleet, only to die here, their cold corpses drifting in the black. The inner stars. What an utter shit show.
A new assignment. Stellar date, October 9, 8948, adjusted years. Location, Ol Sam, ISF I-2. Region, Outer Silstrand System, Silstrand Alliance. Sera stepped off the maglev to see Nadine waiting for her on a bench, tucked under a tree at the edge of the platform. The hand agent, possibly former hand agent, didn't see her right away, and Sera took a moment to observe the woman. Nadine seemed older than Sarah's records showed, tired and sad. Her report on the events of the last month made for an interesting tale, to say the least. Some of it was nearly impossible to fathom, such as Maverick becoming the president of Gedry. Maverick, of all people! Nadine had been sent to the Silstrand Alliance for one reason. Get close to Kylie Rhoads, and work out a way to stop her father before he massed the fleet which now lay in ruin around the I-2. Instead, Nadine had fallen in love with Kylie Rhoads. Not just for the purposes of the mission, but for real. And in doing so, she had delayed meeting her objective.
again and again. "President Tomlinson." Nadine jumped to her feet and almost saluted before simply folding her hands before herself. "Agent Nadine," Sera said as she approached. "I'm glad that we're able to meet under such serene circumstances." Nadine glanced around herself at the forest surrounding the maglev station as though she hadn't noticed it before. "It's quite the ship." Sera nodded. "That's putting it mildly. Walk with me." Nadine fell in beside Sera as they walked through a shaded path in the woods, neither woman speaking for the span of a minute. Eventually, it was Nadine that broke the silence. "I screwed up. A lot." Sera blew out a long breath. "Fucking right you did. Petra sent you in 5 years ago. 5 years. You could have had Kylie Rhoads back with her dear old dad in 6 months, tops." "Never would have worked," Nadine countered, her tone more sad than hostile. "Kylie was estranged from her parents for a decade. She had no interest in seeing them. Just hinting at her family made her shut down emotionally." "Well, in the end, you had to dump her on a ship and send her to her family unwillingly. Seems like waiting didn't get you anywhere." Nadine stopped and turned to face Sera, her eyes narrowed. "Things don't work so easily all the time in the field. Human emotional responses are..." "Nadine," Sarah's tone was frank, "don't give me that. I spent decades in the field. Stars, these are my old stomping grounds. I've flown every route there is in the fringe. I even know half the captains in Gedry. Drank most of those under the table. So don't you give me things are different in the field."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.